I want somebody to go home today with the mind that you are more than eyes can see. It may be your own eyes, it may be the eyes of other men around you, but you are more. I heard of a story which I know a lot of people think, a lot of children can talk about. A story we all know. Solomon Grande, born on Monday, Christian on Tuesday, married on Wednesday, took heel on Thursday, got worse on Friday, died on Saturday, buried on Sunday. And then the story will conclude, that is the end of Solomon Grande. And that is how it is with so many persons in our society today. They were born, they were married, they took heel, and they died. And that is the story. But I know that that will not be your story in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Our society today, they always look for the shortcuts to hard, productive work. The society we find ourselves today look for shortcuts. The mindset, the mentality that is taught to the youth today is the work ethic. Get to work. Go to school. When you finish school, so that you can look for a job. Look for a job. It's what everybody is thinking about. Look for a job. So many people are into what they don't even know. Why they are there? Why am I in this profession? Why am I doing what I'm doing? A lot of people don't know. They just grew up with the mindset that when I go to school, the next thing I do is, as I graduate, I need to look for a job. But that is not how it's supposed to be. That is not how it is supposed to be. And that is the reason why a lot of people grow up and they believe in, when they see a problem, they look at the problem and continue living. A lot of people do not come up with the mindset of being problem solvers. It is very, very difficult for you to see somebody that sees a problem and decides to be the solution to the problem. But that is what God created us to be. Problem solvers. Problem solvers. People generally fall into three groups. We have a few that make things happen. We have many that watch things happen. We have the majority that don't have a notion of what happens. I wonder which one you fall into. Three groups, generally. Few make things happen. Many watch things happen. And majority don't know what happens. They are just there for being there. And that is the majority. And when you classify these three groups of persons, we see those ones that are chameleons in nature, or maybe they have grown to become chameleons. But that is not what God made them to be. We see those that are thermometers, and we also see those that are thermostats. What do I mean by chameleon? The chameleon, wherever he finds itself, it takes color from its environment. And that is what a lot of people do with their lives. Wherever they find themselves after is, what can I get from here? What is due me? What can I get? They are never after, what can I put into my environment? They come up in a family, they look at, what does my father owe me? My father has a big company. I'm supposed to get this from my father. I'm supposed to inherit this from my mother. They are always looking for what they can get from their environment. Taking color from their environment to become. Maybe not exactly what God wants them to become. We have the second group, the thermometer. Whenever you put a thermometer to test the temperature of somebody, immediately the thermometer will read what the person's temperature is. And so there are people whose lifestyle is such that they conform to their environments. Wherever they find themselves, they behave the way people that are in that environment behave. They do not live their own lives. They live the life of the environment, of the society where they find themselves. They just conform. They just blend. And somebody may say, after all, the Bible says, when you are in Rome, behave like the Romans. Is that how that scripture is supposed to be interpreted? I don't think so. He said, how can somebody, he said, I'm married in a particular family, and so because everybody in that family comes up in the morning, ties their wrapper on their chest, and walk around looking for stories, does that mean I should be like that? That I came up from a family that no one has a vision to make it in life, has a vision of how can I become? Does that mean that I that have known the truth, I should conform? I should be like them? When you conform to whatever environment, whatever thing you find yourself, wherever you find yourself, you want to blend. You just begin to live that life. You are living as a thermometer. But there are some that have made themselves and decided, I will not be a chameleon. I will not be a thermometer. I want to be a thermostat. One who determines what takes place in my environment. Because a thermostat determines if the water you give to it should become hot, it will give you hot water. If you need a cold water, it will give you cold water. It determines what takes place. How which we here today will make up our mind that wherever we find ourselves, we determine what takes place. Wherever we enter, we will determine what happens. We will not just be there to watch things happen. We will not just be there not knowing what is happening, but we will be there to make things happen. Praise God. The truth is, I've come to find out that our graveyard is the richest place you can possibly go to. Our graveyard is full of so much potential. Our graveyard, if you need wealth, go to the graveyard. If you need success, you need potential, you need something great, just go to the graveyard if you can bring it out. But the truth is, so many potentials are in the graveyard and it remained as potential. It did not go beyond the name potential. And graveyard, a lot of people, they came into this world with a lot of dreams. If I should ask you, what are your dreams? You will tell me you have a lot of dreams. You will tell me a lot of dreams. Let's say you get to 40, 45, 50. Will you still have those dreams? Will those dreams still be alive? Will those dreams still be alive? I want you to take down these questions. Because within these questions, you will find an answer to a lot of things you may want to ask. Ask yourself, who am I? Ask yourself, why am I here? Ask yourself, how much potential do I have? How much potential? By what criteria should I measure my ability? By what criteria should I measure my ability? And then, Who sets the standard? Who sets the standard? Is it me? Is it the people around me? Is it my father? My friends? Who sets the standard? By what process can I maximize my ability? By what process can I maximize my ability? What are my limitations? If you can answer these questions, you will see yourself on the pathway to a fulfilled life. You will see yourself on the path to living an effective and a fulfilled life. One of the greatest tragedies that can happen to a man is when potential dies untapped. One of the greatest tragedies that can happen to a man is when potentials die untapped. Look at yourself. Touch yourself. Tell yourself, there is a great wealth of potential in me. Tell yourself, speak to yourself, there is a great wealth of potential in me. I thought somebody is talking to himself or herself in this place. I thought you would speak it with boldness, believing what you are saying. Do you really believe that there is potential in you? Speak it with certainty. Tell yourself, there is a great wealth of potential in me.
There is a great wealth of potential in me.
The truth is, you are more than what you have done. You are more than what you have done. If you have ever done anything in life, you are more than that. A wood hunter went and cut wood, brought the wood to his house, made use of those he felt were useful to him. And then there was a particular one he threw aside, believing it was of no use. Threw it aside. And one day, a sculptor was passing by and saw the wood that has been kept as junk. Trash. He met the wood hunter. He said, can I carry this wood? The wood hunter said, why not? Take it, it's of no use to me. And the sculptor carried the wood, went back home, and worked on the wood, and brought out a beautiful bed from that wood that the woodcutter said was useless. He was able to carve out a very beautiful bed and placed it in front of his house. Some days went by, and then the woodcutter was passing along that street and he saw the beautiful bed. He was attracted to it. He went to the sculptor and said, wow, I love this bed. Can I buy it? The woodcutter said, of course, it is for sale. And the woodcutter bought the bed at a very high price from the sculptor and went home happy over what he has gotten. The woodcutter looked at the man as he was going. That's the sculptor. Looked at the man as he was going and he smiled. He said, he doesn't know that it was his junk that he has paid for. So many of you sitting down here today, There is a bird of potential inside of you that is ready to fly. You are the only one holding that bird of potential. There is something inside of you that is burning inside of you, that maybe for some time you have tried to calm the burning. There is this boiling inside of you of what you can do, of what you can become. But you keep on telling yourself, how can I? It's not possible. I don't have an uncle that can help me. I don't have a father that is wealthy. I don't have this. I don't have this. How can I do this? How can I do that? And the bird is inside looking for a way to come out. I was telling someone a story, was it yesterday or the other day, about a young boy that came up. The parents divorced at the age of 10. The young boy started selling little things he could put his hands on at the age of 6. He started selling, he would pick this, he would sell just to be able to take care of himself. Then by the age of 10, the parents divorced. The father packed his things and left them. And it was more or less the young boy taking care of the mother. The boy could not go to school. He became a street boy. He put his hands into different things just to make sure that he could take care of his mother and himself. He sold, he would pluck fruits, he would sell, whatever he could lay his hands on. He continued like that on the street. One day, he met a group of boys that were into music, hip-hop. He loved the music. He wanted to be a part of them. He went close to them and they chased him away. Say, you cannot be a part of us. You are not dressed like us. So, wow. And this young boy really wanted to be a part of them. But the thought of "you are not dressed like us" gave him an idea. He said, which means there is a particular dressing that goes in line with what these people do. The young boy's mother was a tailor, and he had learned tailoring from his mother. He went back home, picked up some pieces and some kind of clothes that could fit music, could fit those that were into music. He did that, took it to the streets, and wow, a lot of people liked it. He sold good 80 pieces that day, went to the streets, finished it, went back to the market, bought a few pieces, came back again, sold them, and went back, sold them. And people, those that were stars, those that were into music, those that were doing restaurant or that had a particular way they were supposed to dress, started meeting the young boy. We want like this. And the young boy began to make money while he was still working in a restaurant. He began to make money. Within a few months, he was able to raise up to $350,000 from sewing those clothes. He started meeting with persons that he knew there is a particular way they are supposed to be dressed. He will meet them, "Sir, this is how you're supposed to be dressed. I can give you the right dressing for what you do." He began to meet with personalities. He did not bother. He did not remember anymore that he was not even learned. The zeal for becoming somebody ate him up, and he was moving out, running after his purpose, running after him, trying to make it at all costs. And before Obama left seat, Obama gave him an award as the global entrepreneur on fashion. that somebody who did not get an educational training, did not have a training educational. The young man today has been able to raise up more than 10 companies, different companies. Somebody whose father left them at the age of 10, and he had to cater for himself and his mother. He was a street boy, but that did not stop him from becoming a success. There are so many challenges that my first people, you say, what about this, what about that? I want us to look at the life of Abraham Lincoln. He's a man some of you might have heard about. You might have heard of his name. You might have heard his name somewhere. I want to give you a brief description of this man that rose up to become a name in the United States of America, that became somebody not minding the frustrations and the disappointments he met. Abraham Lincoln, in 1832, he lost his job. In 1834, he was elected in the legislature. In that same 1834, he lost his wife. In 1836, he had a nervous breakdown. In 1838, he was defeated as speaker. He wanted to become a speaker. He was defeated in 1838. In 1843, he was defeated again for nomination for Congress. Count the number of defeats he got. In 1846, he was elected to Congress. In 1849, he was rejected for the position of land officer. In 1854, he was defeated for the Senate, but he was still going on. In 1856, he was defeated again for the nomination for Vice President of the United States. In 1858, he was defeated again for the Senate. And then in 1860, he was elected President of the United States. And today, we hear of Abraham Lincoln. He was defeated time and time and time. He even had a nervous breakdown. He lost it. He lost it because of the loss of his wife. But yet, he didn't give up. He picked up himself and continued. Not minding the number of defeats he got, he kept on going. Because he knew that there was something in him that would solve the problem of the United States of America. We started on this journey talking about being a problem solver. He knew he had the solution to the problem of that country. And then, everything in life, everything God created, he created with potential. I've been talking about potential, we have not looked at potential. Everything in life was created with potential and possessed the potential principle. Everything in life. In every seed, there is a tree. In every seed, there is a tree. In every boy, there is a man. In every girl, there is a woman. In every cow, there is a head. In every flock, in every bed, there is a flock. Within you, there is something that is born. When the tree dies as a seed, when the tree dies as a seed, it means the tree will never be seen. Tragedy strikes. When that man that is supposed to be a man dies as a boy, It means that man will not be seen. And what happens if you die with your potential? It means what God has invested in you will not be seen by your generation. May it not be your portion in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Let's look at Matthew chapter 25. Matthew 25. We're going to read 14 to 30. Matthew 25. We're going to read 14 to 30. We'll be giving room for a few comments and a few questions at the end of this talk. Matthew 25:14-30. The Bible says, "For the kingdom of heaven is as a man traveling into a far country, who called his own servants and delivered unto them his goods. And unto one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, and to another 1, to every man according to his several ability, and straightway took his journey. Then he that had received the 5 talents went and traded with the same, and made them other 5 talents. And likewise, he that had received 2, he also gained other 2. But he that had received 1 went and digged in the earth, and hid his Lord's money. After a long time, the Lord of those servants went, and so he 5 talents came and brought other 5 talents, saying, 'Lord, first unto me 5 talents. Behold, I them 5 talents more.' His Lord said unto him, 'Well done, thou good and faithful servant. Thou hast been faithful over a few things. I will make thee ruler over many things. Enter thou into the joy of the Lord.'" And that's what happened to us, the one with the 2 talents also. But let's look at what happened to the one with 1 talent. Verse 24. It said, "Then he which had received the 1 talent came and said, 'Lord, I knew thee that thou art an hard man, reaping where thou hast not sown, and gathering where thou hast not strawed.'" Verse 25. That's where I want us to really put emphasis. He said, "And I was afraid. And I was afraid of what people would say. I was afraid of failure. I was afraid of not doing it well. I was afraid I didn't have the ability. I was afraid I did not have the capability. I was afraid. And I hid. I was afraid." He said, "There thou hast that is thine." Verse 28. He said, "Take therefore the talent from him and give it unto him which hath 10 talents. For unto everyone that hath shall be given, and he shall have abundance. But from him that hath not shall be taken away even that which he hath." That's where it really surprises me. He said, even the one that does not have, the one he has. How come? Jesus said, the one that does not have. He said the person does not have. But at the same time, he said the one he has shall be taken from him. Which means there is nobody that came into this earth empty. Even if you see yourself as not having, there is still something in you. There is still something that your generation is waiting to get from you. There is still something your community needs from you. There is still something your family needs from you. Because God made everyone to be a solution. There is a seed in you that only you can nurture and make it grow to become something that will be needed by your world. And so, you must refuse to be satisfied with your last accomplishment, because the problem we have is whenever we have done one thing, we feel we are so, we just want to relax. We always want to rest on our last success. We succeeded in this. We just want to rest. We feel we have accomplished. We feel we are successful. We feel it is okay. So long as I have gotten this job, so long as I am doing this. And then you forget that that is not the best you can possibly be. That you have gotten the job does not mean that that is all there is to your life. That you have done a particular thing and you are successful in that thing, that is not the end there is to you. You are more than that. You are more than that. And as we talk about potential, what are we talking about? Potential is dormant ability. Potential is reserved power. The power you have not used. The ability that lies dormant in you, you have not made use of it. That is potential. Potential is untapped strength. The strength you have not made use of. The strength you have not made use of. I saw a young boy over there that climbed the ladder and was pouring concrete. Into the beam they are making over there. Had they been the masons were present, he wouldn't have known that he would be able to do it. That strength he used in pouring that concrete, he wouldn't have made use of it. And it would have been dormant within him. He would not have known that he is capable of going as far as. So when we talk about potential, we're talking about your unused success. The success you have not seen. Any success you have seen is no longer potential. Any strength you have used is no longer potential. It is the one that you have not used that is potential. The one that lies dormant inside of you. The one that is crying inside of you, looking for a way to come out. It wants to come out. It wants to be seen. That's why the Bible says that the whole of creation is groaning, is waiting for the manifestation of the sons of God. It's waiting for your manifestation because there is something inside of you that you have not made use of. Talents you have not started using, it is hidden inside of you. It is capability. It is all you can be, but you have not. It is all you can do, but you have not done. You have not done it, but you can do it. Because God has put into you the ability to do it, but you have not done it. And that is why it groans inside of you. That is why it yearns. There is this pain inside of you. I want to do this. I want to do this. I want to be this. I want to do like this. And then sometimes you try to bring in some excuses and you see yourself relaxing again. And that thing continues to boil within you. Potential is unexposed ability and latent power. Unexposed ability. Unless you do something beyond what you have done, you will never grow or experience your full potential. Unless you do something more than what you have done. You must do more than what you have done. Were you able to lift up this mic? Then you must be able to lift up to mine. Or you should be able to lift up something that is more than this. Going the extra mile. Putting in an extra effort, bringing out something that you didn't know you could do it. You never knew it is something that you can do. But wow, you've done it. It is inside of you. is inside of you. And so, you must never let what you cannot do to interfere with what you can do. There's a difference with what you cannot do and what you can do. You should be able to identify what you can do and do it. And don't allow what you cannot do to interfere with what you can do. Don't. So, the greatest tragedy that can happen to anyone in life is not death. Hello?
Hello, ma.
The greatest tragedy that can happen to anyone in life is not death. It's a life that never realized its full potential. You ended halfway. You stopped halfway. A life that never realized its full potential. That is the greatest tragedy that can happen to any man. Because potential does not have a retirement plan. Potential does not have a retirement plan. We have the potential principle. Potential principle. In Genesis 1, we're going to read verse 11. Genesis 1, verse 11. Genesis 1, 11. And God said, let the earth bring forth grass, the herb yielding seed, the herb yielding seed, and the fruit tree yielding fruit after his kind, whose seed is in itself, whose seed is in itself upon the earth. And it was so. God said, let the earth yield, bring forth fruit, trees, herbs, that has its seed in itself, which means your seed is within you. It is not something you look for outside. It is inside of you, because that is how God created it to be. God created everything to begin as a potential, to begin as a seed, and it takes a gradual process. Every seed, there is no seed you plant today and you expect to reap from the seed today. It takes a gradual process. And that's why our talking will take a gradual process. Every seed must be nurtured. Every seed must be worked on. But thank God that God said, at the end, he said, be blessed. God blessed the seed. Which means that when we talk about blessing, we're saying, God was saying, I give you permission to. That's been blessed. Permission to prosper. Permission to become. Permission to be whatever you want to be. Permission to fulfill your potential to become what you are supposed to be. Praise the Lord. So, potential is always present, waiting to be exposed. Potential is always present, waiting to be exposed. As we talk, you can be thinking within you, what is that thing that is boiling inside of me that I know I have not tapped into? I know I have not made use of, but something is telling me that I can do it. I can do it. It will be an error that every year you are the same. It will be an error, in fact, that the way you ended last year is the way this year will end for you. It will be an error. If the highest you could get to last year is the highest you would also get to by the end of this year, it will be an error. Because what God has put inside of you is such that there should be an increase. there should always be an increase. He said, take dominion. He said, multiply, replenish the earth, which means increase. God never expects anybody to remain the same way. Never. Praise the Lord. And so, there are many selves within you that lie dormant inside of you. There are many selves. There are many aspects of you that you have not known. There are many aspects of you that you have not known. It is left for you to dig deep inside of you and begin to search for, what is that aspect of myself that I have not tapped into? What is that aspect of myself that I have not gone in to dig deeper to know that I can do this? What is it? What is it? It's not for you to be satisfied with the level you are now. No, you shouldn't be satisfied. You should not be satisfied. There should be a hunger in you to always want to become better. To always want to become better. Because you are not yet the best that God made you to be. There are abilities inside of you. There are successes inside of you. You have gifts inside of you that needs to be explored. There are a lot of things. If I may ask, what if your father died before you were conceived? Which means you wouldn't be here. And if you were not here, what would your generation have lost because you were not here? Just ask you a very big question. That will lead you to identify what you have not tapped out of yourself. Ask yourself, what if my father died before I was conceived? Does it mean I will not be here? Which means I will not be on earth. And you being here, it means you have something to give back to your world. You should be able to determine what happens around you. You should be able to determine what is that thing that you are here to solve. What is that problem you are here on this earth to solve? What is that problem? Why are you here? Why are you here? Failure is not the absence of success. You can be successful in one area, successful in all areas. Failure is not the absence of success. That you are not seeing success does not mean that you are a failure. Failure is the neglect of trying. You refuse to try. That is failure. When you see excuses all around you, you see mountains all around you, and you just decide, what will I do now? What will I do? That is when you're a failure. Something is boiling inside of you to do. And then you tell yourself, if I put my hands into this thing, will I come out? If I go this way, how far can I go? How much will I do it? How like this or how like that? And you find yourself going backwards. It is when you don't try, that is when you are a failure. And may the Lord help us, that no one sitting down in this place today or hearing me, that will be a failure. Amen. In the name of Jesus. Amen. Because you have what your generation needs. You have what your family needs. You have what your community needs. You have what somebody that is close to you is in need of. It is left for you to look up and say, I can do it. I have the strength in me. I have the word of God. We're going to take not more than 2 questions. If you have a question there, very fast, let me see you. Stand up if you have a question, please. Just stand up. Let me see the number of persons that have questions. Stand up.
We have one, two. Okay.